Hello friends, I'm Guna Madhivanan, current affairs faculty at Offices IAS Academy. In this video, we will be discussing our 132nd current affairs hit list topic, that is regarding BEPS, that is base erosion profit shifting. So what is this BEPS? Let us take an analogy. So let me take an example through which let me try to make you understand about this base erosion profit shifting. Okay. So let us take a firm in India. Okay, so I'm taking, okay, Guna is running a biryani factory. Okay, so Guna's biryani. Okay, so Guna's biryani or biryani factory, whatever. So this Guna's biryani, my company, which is making a profit of 1,000 crores, which is making a profit of 1,000 crores by selling biryani all across the country, pan India biryani store. Alright, so by selling biryani alone, Guna is making 1,000 crores of profit. So if Guna is making 1,000 crores, then what should be the tax Guna has to pay? So Guna has to pay a tax of 30%. So Guna has to pay a tax of 30%. So that means tax amount alone is going to be 300 crores. So Guna is putting all his hard work and he is making a profit of 1,000 crores and he is ending up paying 30% tax, that is 300 crores. Now Guna is worried because Guna's hard earned money, 300 crores as tax to be paid to the government. So Guna is thinking that, is there any way, is there any tax planning strategy, is there any loopholes in the law, is there any gaps in the tax treaties which can be exploited to benefit Guna? So Guna is thinking. So Guna is asking his friends, Guna is asking his auditors. So Guna's friends, auditors, they are coming up with a solution. So Guna clearly says that Guna is not interested in hiding his income. Guna is not interested in evading taxes. So Guna is not ready to do anything which is illegal, or I would say Guna is not ready to do anything which is against the law. But however, Guna wants to make sure that he is not deviating from the law. But however, Guna wants to make use the gaps available in the law and save a lot of tax money. So Guna is asking the friends and advocates, auditors, and they are saying that, Guna, there is a country called as Mauritius. So Guna is saying, okay, yes, there is a country called as Mauritius. I know there is a country called as Mauritius. So Guna's friends are saying, Guna, you open a firm in Mauritius. You open a company in Mauritius. Okay. So Guna says, okay, I am starting a company in Mauritius. Then Guna friend says, Guna, what you do? You transfer some of your Guna's biryani stores rights to that company. My friends are saying that, Guna, you go and open a company in Mauritius, a new company in Mauritius. So Guna also obeyed. Guna is opening a company in Mauritius. And Guna's friends are saying that, Guna, what you do, you transfer some of your Guna's biryani firm's rights to this company. So they are saying, if Guna's biryani is having some intellectual property, you sell that intellectual property to this Mauritian company. Mauritian companies also want to be Guna only, but they are saying you do that. So Guna is thinking, intellectual property, what will be the intellectual property for biryani factory, for Guna's biryani store? So Guna thought, okay, masala is the actual core intellectual property of Guna's biryani. So what Guna's biryani, this firm, that Guna's biryani firm, right, Guna's biryani factory, or I would say Guna's biryani factory. Okay, so this Guna's biryani factory, what they are doing, they are selling their intellectual property, IP rights to this Mauritian firm. Guna's biryani factory's intellectual property. What is the intellectual property for biryani? It is masala. The actual masala is the intellectual property, which is very, very unique. That is why Guna is able to make 1,000 crores profit. So that masala, masala idea, that masala ingredients composition, that formula, that intellectual property, Guna's Biryani is selling to this new firm. Okay, let us give a name for this new firm. This new firm name is Masala Factory. Alright, Masala Factory, assume. So, this Guna's Biryani is a separate firm. Masala Factory is a separate firm. Masala Factory is in Mauritius. So, what Guna is doing? Guna is selling the Guna's Biryani's intellectual property rights to this Masala Factory. Now, this Masala Factory, it is owning the intellectual property rights. So, accordingly, what happens whenever Guna is selling biryani, assume if biryani is sold for 100 rupees per plate, whenever Guna is selling biryani, then from that 100 rupees, some amount should go to Masala Factory as royalty. Why? Because the masala's rights is with a different company. So whenever Guna is selling biryani in India, Guna has to pay some royalty to that Mauritian company. And remember, Indian biryani company is also owned by Guna. Mauritian Masala Factory is also owned by Guna only. But however, both are two different entities. Keep that in mind. But Guna is the owner. So what Guna is doing here? Biryani factories, intellectual property rights, that masala rights, Guna is selling to that Mauritian company. Now, whenever Guna is selling biryani in India, royalty has to go to Mauritian company. So, what happens? Out of this 1000 crores, for every 100 rupees, royalty has to be gone. So, out of this 1000 crores, some amount will be going to Masala Factory. So, just for the sake of understanding, I'm saying that the royalty amount to be paid is 70%. That means whenever Guna is selling 100 rupees worth of biryani in India, 70 rupees should be given to Masala Factory. That is the agreement. See, practically it will not happen like that. For the sake of understanding, I'm saying. So whenever Guna is selling 100 rupees worth of biryani in India, 70 rupees he has to give it to Masala Factory. Why? Because Masala Factory is owning the masala rights. Using that masala only, Guna's Biryani is making biryani in India. So, for that purpose, we have to share some revenue. Some money has to be given. So, for every plate 100 rupees, every biryani sold in India, for in every 100 rupees, 70 rupees should go to Masala Factory. That means, from this 1000 crores, effectively 700 crores will go to Masala Factory. So, this will become 300 crores. So, what happens now? Guna's Biryani in India makes 300 crores. Masala Factory in Mauritius make 700 crores. Now, for 300 crores, if you have to pay tax of 30%, you end up paying 90 crores. See, what happened previously? You were making a profit of 1000 crores and you were paying a tax of 300 crores. Now, because of this arrangement, for 300 crores only Guna is going to pay tax, that is going to be 90 crores. So, finally, if you see, 210 crores has been saved. Now, you may ask, all right, sir, but 700 crores, it goes to Mauritius, right? 700 crores goes to Masala Factory in Mauritius. Now, Mauritius government can tax, right? When Indian government is taxing 30%, then Mauritian government will also tax, right? So, when they tax, ultimately Guna is going to face loss. Here where we have to understand, Mauritius, it is a tax haven. It is a low tax destination. Mauritius is a tax haven. It is a low tax destination. That means in India, the tax may be 30%. In Mauritius, the tax will be very, 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 very low. 0.01%, 0.03%. Like that, the tax will be almost zero. So, what Guna has done effectively here? Guna has shifted his profit. Earlier, 1000 crores profit Guna was making it in India. Now, by this arrangement, Guna is shifting the profit. Base erosion, profit shifting. The tax base was originally in India. Through this arrangement, the base is getting eroded. It goes to Mauritius. So, by we are shifting the profit by eroding the base. Base erosion, profit shifting. Right? And why I am choosing Mauritius? Because Mauritius is the tax haven. So, eventually, I will make a lot of money. I can save a lot of money. Originally, 300 crores Guna was paying as tax. But now, through this arrangement, Guna is end up paying only 90 crores. So, 210 crores Guna is able to save. Guna may be getting benefited. But government, 210 crores loss for government. You may ask, sir, okay, sir, but now money goes to Mauritius. From Mauritius, how it will come back to India? There are many methods. We have participatory notes, methodology methods, right? We have various round-tripping processes. Through participatory notes, we can easily bring the money back to India. What is, about this round-tripping and all, we will discuss later in some other video. Let us restrict our discussion only to this base erosion profit shifting as of now. So, I hope you got some idea. Through this arrangement, Guna is paying less tax. Because of this, Guna may save money, but government is losing a lot of money. See, this is a tax avoidance strategy. You have to understand, this is not a tax evasion. It is a tax avoidance strategy. It is a tax planning. There are some loopholes. There are some loopholes. There are some gaps present in this tax system, legal system, that mismatches, that gaps Guna is making use of, and he is saving, he is escaping from lot of tax liability. So, globally, hundreds of billions of dollars is being lost for government. So, OECD and G20, OECD and G20, they spent a lot of time and they came with an action plan. They came with a multilateral convention. They came with a framework and they are asking the countries to adapt this framework. This action plan, this framework tells the government that you have to tweak your tax laws, you have to modify your tax laws. Only when you modify your tax laws, you can, you know, curb this base erosion profit shifting. So, OECD, and G20 countries, they sat together and they came with a framework, action plan, a convention, an international treaty they came with. So, that framework, that treaty, that convention has a framework that says that countries, you adapt this framework, you modify your tax laws according to this framework so that we can, you know, address this base erosion profit shifting. In 2017, India has signed in this convention. In 2019, India has ratified this convention too. India has ratified this convention too. So, this is regarding base erosion profit shifting. If you go and take, if you go to OECD website, they will say that BEPS is a tax avoidance strategy. But however, UPSC once in preliminary exam, they asked about BEPS, where they have mentioned it as tax erosion, I mean tax evasion. It is a tax evasion strategy. Tax evasion is illegal, friends. Tax evasion is illegal. Tax avoidance, it is like tax planning. Tax avoidance is like tax planning, right? You plan and you escape from paying taxes, right? So, here you make use of certain tax planning government itself allows. You invest in insurance, you invest in mutual funds, you invest in certain bonds, you invest in certain small saving schemes, you escape from taxes. But there are certain tax avoidance strategy where people, they use the loopholes, gaps present in this tax system and they escape from payment of taxes. Legally, you may not be in a position to take action. Legally, you are not doing something wrong, but morally, you are making huge harm to the society and government. So, tax avoidance is different from tax evasion. Tax evasion is illegal. That is, you are not accounting your original income. Tax avoidance is a planning strategy. It's a planning strategy. So according to OECD website, if you go, they will say BEPS is a tax avoidance strategy. But however, I think in 2016 UPSC prelims, it simply they ask BEPS is sometimes seen in news is related to which among the below ABCD kind of format. Only one option was talking about taxation. One option was saying base erosion, soil erosion, something like that. So they were giving three options were completely irrelevant. Only one option was connected with taxation, and the UPSC statement was saying it is a tax evasion strategy. Actually speaking, it is tax avoidance, not evasion. But still, in 2016 prelims, among the four, only one option was related to tax. That was the correct option too, right? But remember, BEPS, according to OECD, it is an avoidance strategy, right? I hope you got some clarity on BEPS. So base erosion profit shifting is a tax avoidance strategy by which firms make profits in one country and shift them across borders by exploiting gaps and mismatches in tax rules to take advantage of lower tax rates. It results in not paying taxes in the country where the profit is made. Only in India the money is made, but is being escaped. That is called as base erosion, right? So a multilateral convention was an outcome of OECD and G20. So India ratified too. So this will modify India's tax treaties to curb the revenue loss. Now, based on our discussion, I have constructed an MCQ. Find out the right answer and give in the comment section, right? So friends, we have come up with a current affairs MCQ booklet, which covers current affairs from June to November in MCQ format. Question set, solution set will be given. High quality question and solution will be given. It is available in PDF format. If you are interested, you can buy by clicking the link given in the description box. So here I have given the features of my exclusive current affairs program. If you are interested, you can go through. If you want to buy this course, you can click the link given in the description box. If you have any doubts, you can make a call to the number given here, right? It will be an online live current affairs class session. Recorded videos will also be given to you. You can watch it according to your convenience n number of times, right? Friends, I hope the video was useful. Tomorrow I will meet you with another important, interesting, exciting topic. Till then, bye, take care.